So am I still waiting? Waiting a long time.
Waiting for tonight. Oh.
Listen to REVIEW-A-WAI.
Right now, right? That's what you say. We get it by now.
Do you want to break it all from any reviews, man? Like, I feel you're kind of burning out on some.
They're just, like, the shows are a little... I just need to, like... For me, it's, like, I need to be interested.
Yeah.
Like, I need something, like... I thought this week was fine. It was, like, a little long.
Yeah.
But, like, watching the main event was cool. I was interested in that.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, I think your typical three-hour shows just have... It just has, like... It takes too long, and like it just has too much filler. That's just like, yeah. Like watching the Lethal Lockdown this week. It's like, what was the point? You know, that Lethal Lockdown match. It's like 30 minutes of it. I didn't need to watch. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know. I just think I think the show needs some relevance.
I am as old as the earth. My essence has existed since the beginning of time, born in frigid blackness, forged by scorching hot flame. I am steel. Cold, merciless, unforgiving. I have no heart. I have no soul. And you mortals cannot conquer me. Here I stand tall and erect, and brave men quiver and fall at my feet. I will rip your skin, tear your flesh, spill your blood, scar your very souls.
Samoa Joe, as much as you want to kick my ass, I want to kick your ass even more.
All the pain you caused me tonight, I return it tenfold.
I am the harbinger of hell, the devourer of dreams.
Domino's God.
He's gonna kill you. Gonna kill you.
With you.
Oh, it's real.
Amen.
Domino's Gratius. In nomine Patri, et Filii, et Spiritus Sanctus. Amen.
Be afraid. Be very afraid.
God have mercy on their souls.
Welcome to REVIEW-A-WAI. It's John Pollock and Wei Ting. He's got a smile on his face.
I'm here.
I am here, my man.
Yeah.
What is going on?
You know, man, just...
Don't say living the dream.
I didn't say that. I would never say that. It's not something I would usually say.
I never have dreams that are so great that I wake up saying, God, I want to live that.
Hey, didn't you dream about doing this, though? Hosting a wrestling podcast?
No.
When you were a kid?
No, I didn't.
What did you dream about? You wanted to be a dentist.
Yeah, that's what I dreamt about cavities.
So you're not living your dream.
Maybe not. I can't say I was heavy on that. Oh, what am I going to be? My dreams. I mean, that's just such a...
A lot of people are, though.
I think that's a saying, though. It's really...
I think for a lot of people, it's true.
Do you go to sleep and your subconscious just drifts into your future desires? Well, no, not really. Usually, your dreams make no sense. Okay, it's usually you on a scooter going off a cliff or something, and then all of a sudden, a pig flies out of the sky.
Yeah,
that's most people's dreams.
I mean, we're not talking about like the type of dream where you fall asleep and... You know, subconsciously think about
something. That's what I think of a dream as.
No, we're talking about dreams like my wish, okay. My hope.
That's a different term.
Whatever.
Hope, I wish, but I dream.
I'm living my hope. Doesn't really sound the same.
I'm executing my plan.
Wow.
Get a nuts and bolts account of
things.
Yeah,
I'd love to know what a 5-year-old's plans are for the rest of his life.
Were you in high school? Did you ever have to go to the guidance counselor to talk about career options? Did you have any of that stuff in high school?
I don't think so. I don't think my school was particularly big on that. I don't recall anything like that. I think that was more for like troubled youth.
Oh.
Like if you got in trouble, then you would have to go and talk about your dreams.
So they just assumed you were on the right path.
Yeah.
Deceiving your friends about your identity. And he would end up fine.
Yeah, I guess so.
20 years from now, this guy will be a very successful podcast host. You might be one of the more well-known graduates of your high school.
Could be. I don't know.
I know that you've had some.
Oh, Paul Bernardo went to my school.
I know, I know. So, if this always comes up, I know you.
Well, I don't know.
You are known for good.
Yeah, sure.
Well, what do you think of our contest on Monday? The lip sync contest.
I thought it was great. I don't know how other people feel because they're probably seeing this. They probably haven't seen the video yet.
See, I feel this is very analogous to TNA Lockdown.
Okay.
Because people look back at Lockdown, they're like, man, what a great build up for this unique main event. How did the creative team get this so right when they used to get so much wrong? And that's because you have to look at some of the key points. It wasn't just one person doing creative at the time. You had Jeff Jarrett, you had Dutch Mantel, and you had Vince Russo. So typically, I mean, people looked at, I mean, this was kind of a Jarrett Dutch Mantel influence on the main event. So to our contest, this was a John Pollock contest idea where I think you are the better idea generator of contests.
That's not true.
And I think when we do a future contest, you will have one that is better received by our listenership.
No, don't say that, John. I thought this contest went really well.
And we got some nice, those that did submit, I will forever be indebted to you.
Yeah.
Because you made this a fun contest as a result.
That's right. And,
while most scoffed at the notion of looking foolish on camera.
Yep. And we should remind people, if you want to check out the results of this contest, it's all in a video that will be up
Thursday? Maybe? This week.
This Thursday.
Okay, this Thursday.
It'll be up on Thursday.
Perfect.
Yeah.
And you can find out if you are one of those entrants, if you are the winner.
Yeah.
And the prize as well will be something.
Will we announce the prize? Or did we announce the prize? I forget. Did we?
Wait, you've got to pay attention on Mondays.
And what's the answer?
Go back and listen if you have to.
Oh, my. Okay. Maybe that's the fault with these contests.
We never announce a prize ahead of time?
We don't even announce it after we've announced the winner.
Well, maybe one of these days, you're gonna find out that something that comes your way, you weren't even expecting. What a win this was, just by entering.
No.
That's called good faith in us.
No, I don't think so. I don't think anyone cares that much anymore.
Did you watch game one of the Raptors and Heat last night on Tuesday? I feel there's certainly a big buzz around the Raptors.
Yeah.
But I feel it's nowhere in the league of the Jays last fall.
Maybe to you and I think it depends on your social circle, I feel. You could be right though. The city as a whole, maybe for some reason the Jays might be more of a
I feel that was more of a national following, whereas the Raptors I don't feel translate nationally to the degree that the Blue Jays
did. That's interesting. You might have something there. Although I wonder if it's more of a demographic thing. Like I wonder if you know, maybe younger people might be more into the Raptors. It's hard to say. But also, I feel like making it into the playoffs in a baseball setting is a bit bigger, much more of a bigger deal than it is in basketball.
Right.
Where like half the teams basically make it into the playoffs. You know?
Yeah, there's something to that. I think the,
only like 8 teams get to make it to the playoffs, right? In baseball?
Yeah. I'm
making numbers up, so don't even bother fact checking me.
So I'm looking at ratings here from, just a week ago. Okay. So this is not like game 7 or anything that they just had with the Pacers, but we had, okay, to put this into perspective. Okay. The prelims for UFC 197, the recent John Jones Ovin St. Preux card on TSN did 173,000 viewers. That was on, it says here TSN. I believe it was on TSN 4 and 5. To compare that to the same night, the Raptors and Pacers game on that same Saturday on Sportsnet did 379,000 viewers. But I don't think that's an apples to apples comparison with the TSN reach versus the Sportsnet reach, but right. I could be wrong because it just says Sportsnet TSN here. It's not stating specifically
Which version?
Did you watch the game last night?
No, I didn't watch. I've not watched any.
You're not hopping on the bandwagon. I thought Game 7 was the best time to jump on the bandwagon.
Well, it was a little busy Sunday night.
Oh, yeah.
There was payback.
Yeah.
So I watched that. So you watched Game 7 instead.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow. As you turned your phone off all weekend. And ignored people.
Yeah.
Like a real dick.
Yeah.
I understand.
I'll tell you about that off air.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Can you tell us if you got a new phone or not?
No, but I might be.
Oh, boy.
I'm in the market now.
You're in the market?
Yeah.
Wow.
I'll tell you about it.
You're going to head to Dufferin Mall?
Maybe.
Oh, there's a few things you can pick up there. All right. Well, we're going to chat about Lockdown today from 2008. This is the rationale me and Wei give. Samoa Joe just won the NXT title in Lowell, Massachusetts.
Yep.
And he won the TNA title in Lowell, Massachusetts.
Oh, I didn't even know that.
Well, I did say it on this show last week.
Okay.
Thanks for paying attention.
I wasn't paying attention.
And thus, we're going to review this show.
Yeah. Also, I thought another tie-in for me personally was because last week we reviewed Backlash 2001 featuring Kurt Angle, Chris Benoit match that was very much of a shoot style.
I thought the same thing, and I didn't even
match.
I didn't even put those two together when we picked this review.
Yep. And so, Samoa Joe versus Kurt Angle from TNA Lockdown 2008, of course, was their very famous MMA-inspired match. So,
which was very polarizing at the time. There were people that hated this.
Sure, I could totally see that. So, you know, I thought it was fun and enjoyable for me personally as a fan of shoot-style pro wrestling to compare two Kurt Angle matches, one from 2001 before the boom of MMA and to a match from 2008 after the boom of MMA.
Yes, so this was a show that, first of all, I'm going to praise one of the things I like the best about these TNA pay-per-views. We paid for this, and I had no problem paying for this. This cost $1 to watch.
Who cares about a dollar?
Well,
a Canadian dollar, which is like 40 cents, basically.
Yeah.
American.
So you and I...
Nothing.
You and I contributed more to TNA than the entire last set of any television tapings at Universal Studios.
Sure.
They can't charge.
Yeah.
So they made more money off of you and me in the last week, our $2.
Well, I mean, don't you think they charge...
Well, merchandise they can sell there.
Merchandise in, like, the park?
Doesn't go to TNA.
Oh, okay.
They rent Universal Studios, but then they cannot charge people to get in there.
Maybe they can install, like, a soap dispenser that costs, like, 25 cents.
Oh, that's a good idea.
Yeah.
It's anyway. Like a Roller Coaster Tycoon when it starts raining.
Yeah.
You jack up prices for umbrellas.
Actually, in Europe... A lot of places I went to in Europe, you had to pay to use the bathrooms. You got to pay like a quarter or something to use the bathrooms.
Wow, really?
Yeah.
This is just in public or a private area?
In public.
That sounds lunacy.
Yeah.
I was told when I worked at a movie theater, they once told us, our supervisor was like, if anyone comes over to you here at the New York Fries and asks for a glass of water or a cup of water, you were to say no and direct them to the water fountain. It's like, that seems a little...
What's the reason?
Well, apparently, I don't think it's actually enforceable or even legal that you can deny someone water.
Hmm.
That was my understanding at the time.
Yeah.
So if anyone's in...
But I mean, if the theater was, you know, was giving out free water via the fountain anyway,
what's the difference? I guess that's their...
It's not like a money thing.
That was their thought process, but...
Is it like a health thing?
I don't know what it is.
Hmm.
Okay. I think that's kind of
interesting. But anyway, I don't know why we were talking about that.
So, sometimes we go down paths and it's a dead end. So you got to turn around, go back, and get on track.
Yeah.
As I don't drink water. We have two unnamed brands of coffee here.
Yeah.
Competing brands that have a history together.
Yep. Both good.
Both are good. Is there any hot chocolate in your drink?
No.
Oh, this is solid coffee.
Mm-hmm.
And you're in a more lively mood. So I think there's something
to learn
here. I think sugar and chocolate as a byproduct, I think that's a downer for you.
I think it's also because I also have some car that I have parked that I need to.
Oh, do you have to move. Get going?
Yeah.
Oh, are you on the clock?
Yeah, I am.
Oh, so you want me to get into this review?
Yeah, pretty much.
Well, that reminds me of when I was 14. No, I'm kidding. Okay. This was a show, anyway, that Wei and I paid for, once again, contributing our $2 combined to buy two separate versions of this.
$2 to TNA, although we should quickly remind people, if you want to see matches like this and more from TNA's history.
Oh, you're going to work a plug in here.
Look no further than the Fight Network.
That's right.
TNA's greatest matches every Tuesday.
Yes, they air a lot. That show airs all the time on the Fight Network.
And it does great on the Fight Network, doesn't it? I hear it does.
You'd know better than me.
I wouldn't know. I don't get results to ratings. But actually, it's the show that airs right after a Review of Raw.
Mm-hmm. I want it. You know, sometimes I feel there's a balancing act here. I don't want to go overboard and then sound, oh, these guys, they're just shilling stuff. But then it really bugs me when we recently announced the Ring of Honor deal, and you'll hear from some people who are just like, oh, wow, guys are airing wrestling now?
Like, exactly. Yeah, people don't know.
I was like, should we be noting more? It's like, it's not my job to get on here and just plug stuff. But at the same time, it's like, seriously, if I was not working here, I mean, and you're in Canada, like, no, there's no WWE on the Fight Network. But there is a lot of stuff on there from AAA now, CMLL. It's the only place to watch Impact.
Yep.
And then you mentioned, yeah, greatest matches.
Yeah. I mean, I don't even.
And I know there's other stuff they're working on too. I mean, I think they have found a good amount of wrestling and finding that wrestling fans, it's easier to me to sell people on non-WWE wrestling than it is non-UFC MMA.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, for sure. From my perspective, I don't even really think about that. I just think about, I guess getting the word out. And also the fact that they are paying for this show, essentially. You know?
Who?
The Fight Network.
Paying for what show?
This.
Oh, for this?
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess. Brought to you by the Fight Network.
Yeah, so.
And our coffee.
But at the same time, if something is shit, we will talk about it. Like, it won't influence. I mean, we've carried the UFC, you know, for like 2 years now, and you guys don't hesitate to talk about when something's bad at the UFC. Just like, if there's something bad on this episode of Lockdown 2008.
Oh, and there is.
I will not.
There's a lot
to talk about.
This is hardly a rose-colored glasses review of Lockdown 2008, but I will say the environment and this crowd, this crowd was incredible
mm-hmm.
in Lowell, Massachusetts. This crowd, and I found that it was like the audience you could tell was lively, but not always. I don't know if it was a miking issue or just the way the audio feed was. To me, they were. I could tell they were louder than they were coming across watching this on
really?
The YouTube version to me.
Really?
Yes. There were points where it's like you could tell they were chanting, but it was lower than I could tell that they actually were at the time.
Okay. Maybe. Yeah. I didn't necessarily get that sense myself. If anything, I felt like they sounded louder than they actually looked, but.
This was reviewing a completely different TNA.
Yeah.
How many people on this entire card? Forget wrestlers. People that appeared on this card that are still with the company. Any guess?
I don't know.
Just throw out a number.
Six.
Three.
Wow.
Three people that we saw. One of being Jeremy Borash.
Oh, my.
The others being Gail Kim and James Storm. Everybody else. And believe me, there were a ton of multi-person matches. So a lot of bodies on this card.
Oh, Borash.
They're all gone.
Borash is, I think he's a lifer. There's... You know,
that guy should be doing commentary on Impact every week. He recently filled in for the Pope. That guy is the most versatile person in TNA, and I think he's the most undervalued performer in that company for sure.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I would have that guy doing commentary every show.
Yeah, but then who's going to take over his other job? Whatever he does.
Ring announcing?
I'm sure he does plenty other jobs that don't.
I know he does a lot. I'm just saying that I think he's. He's a guy that doesn't, to me, get his due as a very capable announcer.
Definitely.
So we start the show off with, I mean, maybe Triple H just watched Lockdown when he decided to do those dramatic monologues inside of a ring to open up a takeover special, because here we got Mike Tenay in the ring setting the scene for tonight's main event. And we will answer the question if this is Samoa Joe's last stand.
Yeah, this was like a...
Is this a spoiler if we say it wasn't his last stand in 2008?
No, I don't think
so. Are we spoiling anything?
No. Samoa Joe does not retire after this match, yes. I thought a cool way to start this show, you know, empty arena, just Tenay in a cell. Tenay in a cell all by himself.
In a TNA cell? TNA,
wow.
TNA
oh, my God. Mike TNA.
Mike TNA.
That's why he got hired. So, you know, I
once told that joke to him, and he thought it was rather amusing, actually.
Did you?
Yes.
I'm embarrassed.
Actually, to be honest, I made that joke, but it was definitely not me that came up with it, because Mike Tenay used to do a column on TNA's website, and he used to spell his last name like he used hyphens in there to emphasize that. So I stole the joke that I told him from him.
So you retold.
I made some joke about how can you have TNA without Mike Tenay. It was something awful. It was a stupid joke I made.
It's like somebody making a waiting joke to me.
Exactly. Yeah, so he probably just smiled and just threw a dart in my face off.
But a cool a cool way to start off the show, I thought, getting away from your typical, you know, just getting into the opening video.
Yeah, and the build up for this, I mean, this was at a time when TNA, I mean, they did all these wacky characters, their creative people were very down on the creative, but for this build up to Angle and Joe, they got very serious. It was training videos. The guys disappeared for a while, and you just got vignettes of them working. You incorporated Marcus Davis into things, training Samoa Joe.
How long had Kurt Angle been in the company by this point?
Since September of 06.
Okay.
So he had been there a year and a half.
And in that time, he and Samoa Joe had faced each other four times prior to this?
They had faced each other, yeah. They
this
had
was said, the fifth
yeah,
year.
Four times. This was meeting number five.
Right.
Yeah, because... And Joe had beat him in one of those, which in hindsight, I mean, as you look at it, I'm sure they would have loved to have this been his final. Finally, he beats Kurt Angle, but they had done that already. So I think everyone can agree they overdid Angle Joe when they first came in. They did that great number for their first match, and then it just dropped because they did it three straight months and then took a break. And then the fourth match was Hard Justice. Another great TNA pay-per-view name from the prior August.
But you can understand why, you know, for their fifth match, they decided to go maybe a bit of a different creative route in the promotion of the match and even in the style of the match itself, this time doing a much more MMA-based type of build.
Yes. And then the video. This was awesome. This was
definitely a David Sahadi.
Oh, my God. This was David Sahadi and... And God knows what else that contributed to this thought process.
It felt a lot like the Backlash video.
This was aptly titled I Am Steel, where we heard the narrator was speaking from the point of view of the steel structure with such lines as, I have no heart. I have no soul. And you mortals cannot conquer me. Standing tall and erect, rip your skin. Tear your flesh, spill your blood, scar your very souls. I am the harbinger of hell, the devourer of dreams. This sounded like a Kane promo.
Oh my.
But it was a Cage promo.
Yeah, wow. Very nice.
And it ended with the James Earl Jones voice reciting the last rites.
Yikes.
Man, this was how you start off a pay-per-view.
Yeah.
And get pumped.
I thought it was really great. And for the record, I'm not completely sure if it was David Sahadi or not, but
I think this was the Sahadi period.
Sure. Okay. But, nonetheless, very much that same type of feel that, you know, of a video package that you would have seen in, more of the, Attitude Era WWE as well.
Yeah. But I thought some of Sahadi's more wackier stuff came in TNA. I mean, he was really, you got the sense was really had carte blanche on his creative direction.
Did you like this?
The opening video?
Yeah.
I thought it was fine.
I thought it was
a little over the top.
Yeah, but they're very over the top.
I mean,
epic over the top lines. But I think they're cut really well. And overall, I feel like they're, you know, they do a very good job in my
opinion. I will always take this, even if it's, there are some people that will just laugh it off and think lame. It's similar to a UFC commercial. I will always applaud them trying something so different, even if they risk failure versus the generic Goldberg and Joe Rogan sound clips over fight footage that leaves no lasting impression on me whatsoever.
Absolutely.
Don West and Jeremy Borash are shown in different parts of the crowd interviewing some fans, which were great. We had one guy yelling, Samoa is going to win! Samoa! And then we had a mini Steve McMichael who thought he was so clever by saying, Kurt Angle's got it locked down, baby!
You can understand why, like, the WWE never does these go into the crowd to ask fans anymore.
I thought these were ringers that they kind of rehearsed. Because I don't think they really would have trusted these fans to say anything competent on a live
Perhaps.
Mic.
But I mean, Jesus, like the number of the types of people that they got to do these types of little predictions, they just, in the end, you're just left with an impression that these guys are all dorks. And wrestling fans in general, if you were to take them, you know, just by looking at this selection, must all be dorks.
And the big question amongst everybody is, who's going to win? Samoa Joe or Kurt Angle? Who's going to win tonight?
Samoa Joe all the way.
Samoa Joe, who's going to win?
Samoa Joe!
Samoa Joe!
Oh, Kurt Angle all the way. It looks so bad. You make him tap out.
Are you calling them the dork factor?
There is a certain dork factor to these predictions, yes.
Mike TNA and the man who's just like a long-lost best friend, Don West. If there's anyone I miss in all of the departures in TNA history, Don West might be my top three. Mm. This guy was just... I love this guy. This guy got so much flack when he started out. Everyone hated Don West, and he became just such a fun part of TNA.
I think you like him more than I do.
Oh, way, come on.
You would
rather listen to the Pope than Don West.
I wouldn't say
that.
When
was the last time you watched Impact?
What do you mean? Yesterday.
Oh.
Tuesday.
Yeah?
Yeah.
What'd you think?
9 o'clock on the Fight Network.
I miss Don West. I thought he added so much just energy to these. And I thought him and TNA were just a great team together.
My complaint, and I think anytime you go back to one of our reviews of a TNA show featuring Don West, is usually that I think he's very good. And yes, I completely agree with you. I'd much prefer him over many other commentators. But I feel like he's always at a 10. And when you're always at a 10, your 10 becomes a 5. You know, and when you really have to, you know, try to sell those big moments, they just kind of turn into background noise if you're always excited.
Our opening match, which was TNA, I would say in a nutshell, but we'll call it in a cage. Tonight's gimmick was that we, of course, it's lockdown, so it's all cage matches, but we have to come up with all these wacky stipulations for every cage match to varying degrees of success.
It's just like the Don West analogy. You know what I mean? If you're at a 10, cage matches being your 10, you got to come up with 15s, and you got to come up with stipulations on top of stipulations.
Our X Division champion at the time was Jay Lethal, and this was going to be an Xscape the Cage match involving Curry Man, Johnny Devine, Consequences Creed, now Xavier Woods, Sanjay Dutt, and Shark Boy. And this is what they had...
And Black Machismo.
Jay Lethal, yeah.
Oh, sorry. Did you
yeah, defending. Yeah. So, and you're right. It was Black Machismo at the time. So the idea was, at this time, was, well, we have these great wrestlers, but they're just wrestlers. They've got no personality. That always became the narrative.
That's a fair criticism.
Fine. But this, to me, was just, let's make them all comedy characters.
Right.
And that, to me, negated any of the wrestling. Because sure. There was such a disconnect between these goofballs that when the bell rang, they had to just be put on these excellent wrestling matches. And this was not an excellent wrestling match. But look at who you had here and the gimmicks you had put them under. And they just became all... This X Division became a farce of what the original X Division was.
Right.
And I think if you look, as history would dictate, I mean, I'm not calling NXT this golden goose that some people prop it up to be. I mean, there's a lot of NXT, if it was not under the WWE umbrella, would face so much more criticism because it wouldn't, it's not profitable on its own. But I think you can see that they are much closer to something that clicks with making stars than this was. And it's a lot of the same talent here that was in TNA that they're, the wrestling was never the question. The talent was superb, but the gimmicks were killers for some of these guys.
Well, in NXT, they have, it's very much a cruiserweight brand. Cruiserweight promotion, but they don't brand their cruiserweights as cruiserweights. They don't really have that line at all. And
like here, Finn Balor in TNA 2008 would probably be Hornswoggle. He'd be a life-size Hornswoggle coming out with fucking Lucky Charms and doing a little waltz to the ring with a fucking shillelagh. That would be Finn Balor in TNA in 2008.
Could be.
Because we can't just put out some Irish great wrestler.
Yeah, and I think, though, the X Division in TNA wasn't just the Cruiserweight
division. Mark, he just hit him with the Lucky Charm!
It wasn't just the Cruiserweight division. It was also typically the openers, the undercard. And in the undercard, I guess that's kind of the spot where you throw your comedy in as well. So they were kind of fulfilling that spot of both the fast, agile workers, plus also your kind of comedic value in many parts.
These were our gimmicks. Okay, we had Jay Lethal doing a Randy Savage tribute. Curry Man.
Yeah.
Johnny Devine, whose gimmick was he had turned on the X Division by aligning with the Dudley Boys, who buried the X Division.
And he came up with a camera.
A camcorder on a tripod.
Yeah, and this
was also doing a highspots.com gimmick. He was going to record his matches.
Yes. Was that the actual gimmick?
No, it was not actually.
What was the actual gimmick? Because I forget this. Was he taping for the Dudleys? Because this was after the Paparazzi Productions.
Yes, that had run its course. And Johnny Devine.
He was just taping. He was just bootlegging. He's a bootlegger.
Yeah, that's it.
Maybe he was recording for the Fight Network.
Yes.
Former colleague of ours.
Consequences Creed, who had debuted earlier in 2007. I mean, he had the most this was the only guy who was actually didn't have some wacky gimmick attached to him. Sanjay Dutt, who came out as...
He didn't have a wacky gimmick. At the same time, though, he didn't leave an impression.
No.
You don't think about him after this.
And Shark Boy, who was doing the Austin gimmick.
Oh, yeah. That's right.
Shell, yeah.
Yeah.
Which they just loved.
I thought it was hilarious.
So... It's an elimination match until we get down to two final men, and then it's the first to escape. So we do pinfalls and submissions until the title is on the line, and then it's just simply escape. You don't have to actually beat the opponent.
Sorry, one more time?
Everyone, it's eliminations.
Yeah, until the champion enters?
No. Everyone starts.
Yeah.
And then everyone gets eliminated until we're down to two. And then it's the first one to escape.
I see, okay. So whoever gets pinned and then it's escape. Got it.
This is going to happen a lot throughout this show, having to explain how you win the match.
And I watched the match.
Lethal and Dutt are working together. Of course, Lethal is romantically linked to SoCal Val.
Who's the Liz?
Who's
playing Liz?
Yes, is ringside.
Yeah.
They did a Tower of Doom and everyone goes down except for Devine, who held onto the fence to stay up. Devine rolled up Dutt for the first elimination, about 2:45 in. Then Creed hit the Hammerlock DDT, named the Creed DT.
Okay.
You got it?
Yep.
The Creed DT.
Yeah.
To eliminate Shark Boy, and the crowd boos the elimination of Shark Boy. Curry Man climbs the cage, and Devine shakes it. Devine then misses with a shooting star press off the top rope to the mat. Curry Man then hits a somersault off the top to Creed and Devine. Curry Man eliminates Creed with the spice rack. Then Dutt is watching... after his elimination with SoCal Val on the floor, the spice rack is delivered to Lethal. Devine breaks it up, and he hits the Devine intervention to eliminate Curry Man at 8:30. Then Devine ties Lethal's arm to the rope using tape. Dutt blocks Devine from escaping through the door, and then passes a knife to Lethal to cut the tape and free himself. Devine is climbing, but Lethal is now free. The door opens, and he dives through the ropes and to the floor, crashing down to keep his title at 10:25.
Yeah. Cool.
Escape the cage is what Black Machismo did.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I thought it was a fun match. It was kind of very much your X Division style match, very fast. I thought a lot of very creative multi-man spots. I didn't expect Johnny Devine to kind of be featured as much in this match as he was, but the guy, you know, was part of the final two, and I thought he looked great in the match. You know, I thought the finish with him tying Lethal up in the ropes and then Dutt passing scissors or something, I think it probably looked a lot better on paper than in execution. Like, if it was filmed for a movie, I think the suspense and the drama would have probably played out a lot better. But to see it live, it wasn't one of the stronger parts of the match, but I thought overall it was a really good opener.
Now, after the match, you have Lethal, Val, and Dutt all celebrating. And there was one key spot where Dutt turns away from Lethal to go hug Val. And the camera doesn't pan over to catch this, which to me was the key point here, because that was what they were teasing here, is that Dutt cannot be trusted as Lethal's best friend because he's after Val himself.
Ah.
Which would lead us to a ladder match with Val's, the winner of the ladder match got to like marry Val or something like that. So lots of great stuff in store for the X Division champion.
Cool.
Jeremy Borash is with Frank Trigg backstage to discuss tonight's, quote, big money match.
Yeah, another former Fight Network analyst.
Oh, yeah. And he brings up losses to Matt Hughes and George St. Pierre as Trigg asks if he would like to be punched in the face or the stomach for bringing up these losses. He says it is very nerve-wracking, but Kurt Angle has beaten lots of people, including the Iranian, to win the gold medal. The Iranian. And says Joe has failed in the past to win titles. He does a breakdown and picks Kurt Angle. And then says, nothing against Marcus Davis, but Joe has rushed this camp into 5 weeks. He says, everything's possible. It's possible I could become president of the United States, but it's not likely to happen, to make the analogy for Samoa Joe's chances tonight. So after tonight, Frank Trigg could have become U.S. president.
Could have, but not likely.
No, the guy who had just headlined or been in a featured spot a year ago at WrestleMania was the more likely presidential candidate.
Oh, right. Yeah, who would have thought that?
Honestly, I just don't see a way that Samoa Joe could win this fight.
So even after this intense training in California, nothing he could have picked up along the way, maybe given the advantage, something maybe Kurt wasn't expecting?
Nothing against Marcus Davis. I mean, he is a great competitor. He's a great trainer. You know, Samoa Joe, I talked to him a little bit about, you know, the training camp. He put him through an 8-week training camp, but he smashed it in 5 weeks to kind of make it work together. It's not enough. It is probable. I mean, it's probable that he could beat Kurt. I mean, you know, I could probably be president of the United States. I'm an American-born citizen. It could happen. It's not going to happen. It just isn't going to happen. And it's unfortunate because Samoa Joe has done so much for pro wrestling. And he really has put his heart and his soul and his life into this game that he's going to have to walk away from tonight after he loses. Because, you know, like you said, 5 weeks ago, if I lose, I'm walking away. He's out of here tonight. Hopefully we'll have a good couple bottles of champagne and his going away party.
I thought Trigg was great here. He broke this down like he was actually breaking down an MMA fight. And the addition of him and Marcus Davis, in particular Trigg, though, I thought added a lot of fun, credibility, and
Frank Trigg was one of the shining points of the show.
Yeah, and if you've seen Trigg's work in MMA, you do kind of get a kick out of seeing guys like him act in, you know, this kind of weird pro wrestling environment. And in Trigg's case, doing a good job of playing a heel manager. I thought he actually did very good.
There was so much to be learned here from a guy that had probably never done any promos in pro wrestling before this night. He had been on television, but before this TNA run. And here he comes, and he was just so subtle with his little things.
Yeah.
Like, nothing against Marcus Davis, but, you know, it's so pro wrestling at times to just beat things over the head. Like, we're so stupid that we can't read between the lines. And here's Frank Trigg, who it was just so passive aggressive and great.
Yeah. Trigg just, like, basically, again, did this just like he would have called, broke down a pride match or, you know, and something he would do on a podcast or something, but except he would just kind of add a bit of snark into it, throw a bit of, you know, sarcasm into it. And I thought he handled it perfectly.
Which takes us to our second cage match. It is the Queen of the Cage match. I will need about a half hour to explain this one. Here's our lineup. Christy Hemme, against Salinas versus
Shelly Martinez.
Shelly Martinez.
Current discussion.
Of current discussion fame. Yeah. Jacqueline, recent Hall of Famer. Traci Brooks. Angelina Love. Velvet Sky. Rhaka Khan. And Roxxi Laveaux. The Voodoo Queen.
Yep.
From New Orleans. Rhaka Khan. Mike Tenay said this great. So little is known about Rhaka Khan, about what Rhaka Khan can do in a match, which if you were a viewer of TNA in 2008, you would learn the answer to that question very fast. And you could also learn what she could do, in a personal relationship where things went wrong.
Right.
The rules of this match were that the women would start on the floor. Of course.
It's a reverse battle royal.
This is the forgotten reverse battle royal, kind of, because the first two to climb into the ring would then have a singles match, and the winner would become the number one contender for the Knockouts title.
It's, again, you know, on a show featuring all cage matches, you need to think of creative ways to add some variety, you know, by thinking of different rules using the structure. And I applaud them for trying.
This is how season 18 of Tough should have been, to introduce the women.
But in execution, I think it just comes across rather silly.
Oh, it was.
Ladies and gentlemen, here are the rules for this match. All eight Knockouts will start on the arena floor. The first two to flight and climb their way into the ring will then have a singles match won by pinfall or submission to determine the number one contender for the Knockouts title and will be declared the first ever TNA Knockout Queen of the Cage. It all starts in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, fight!
This is what I love about Lockdown. Yes, every match is in the six sides of steel, but there's that little different hook to every match here at our Lockdown pay-per-view, and you're certainly seeing that on display here.
Everyone fights, and Angelina immediately climbs into the ring. And then Roxxi stops Velvet from climbing in, and it's Roxxi that gets in. We went a minute 38 of these women fighting around where we got the best of the barricade shots.
Oh my God. And
what a waste of time bodies.
These camera guys were zooming in pretty hard on, some of these, Knockouts climbing the cage. That's for sure.
Well, that was, I guess New Japan did learn, or at least took something from TNA. What a stupid, we couldn't have just started this as a singles match, could we? We needed to have all these women out here.
Part of the appeal.
For a minute 38.
Well, I think part of the appeal of, you know, is seeing the entrances and seeing all these girls walking. But yeah, like in the end, totally pretty unnecessary, of course. Yeah. But, you know, let's say you're given the direction to do an all cage match show. You gotta sometimes do things like this.
My best advice would be don't think too hard. You'll hurt yourself.
Yeah.
That applies to most of the steps on this show. So then our match began. Love choked her with a scarf, hit a bicycle kick. Love then hits the lights out and Roxxi kicks out. There was a big chant for Roxxi. And then Roxxi hits the voodoo drop and pins Angelina at 5:27.
Yeah, I thought, you know, short, pretty decent, I guess, for these two. They're going very fast. And yeah, it was all right. These two were in a storyline at the time, Roxxi and Angelina.
Were. Yes, this was culminate with a makeover deal where Roxxi would get her head shaved.
Mm.
Roxxi was a pretty good talent, too. I think she could have been someone like they hired so many women at this point, and a lot of them. I mean, the Knockouts division, it was built a lot around Kim and Kong. Mm-hmm. You had a great act and the beautiful people at this time. But for just sheer bodies to have that you can put in match situations, Roxxi was someone that I think they could have done a lot more with and was kind of just a footnote at this time when I think a lot more could have been done with her. Then Lauren, our new backstage interviewer, is interviewing Joe from earlier in the day. He says he has not given any thought to what he will do if he has to leave wrestling because there is only one outcome. And he did not lay hands on Kurt Angle this past week on Impact, so that Kurt is 100% for tonight's match.
Yeah, this type of earlier Joe promo, you know, it's you can hear him kind of doing a lot of screaming to accentuate, like almost like a Sid promo, in a way. And they're not bad, but they just kind of came across like he was trying to sound like a pro wrestler versus, you know, maybe more telling a story in a way that seemed more genuine, that was able to more connect. And I think he's definitely changed right now.
So if the I Am Steel video was your favorite, my favorite video on this show was the preview for the Battle of the Fake Brothers, Kip and BG James. This featured Kip James alongside a live tiger to emphasize that that is what he will become in the cage tonight. He says, I will stomp your guts out and then we'll feed BG to the live tiger.
My.
Which I was really hoping this would be the stipulation and the tiger would be brought out. Loser is eaten by a tiger. On television, Kip had hit Bullet Bob with a crutch, and then Road Dog cuts a revenge promo. They needed to find a fence to emphasize that this will be in a cage, so they found a local baseball diamond for Road Dog to cut this promo in and vowing revenge on Kip.
Yeah, I remember when my friends and I used to play pro wrestling in recess.
Did you ever use a tiger?
No, but we would use the baseball diamond steel fence as a fence to have to climb over, like, for a steel cage match.
Oh.
Yeah, we used to do that.
Could you, instead of a door, could you walk around the baseball diamond and just exit?
No, I don't think so. No. The goal is to climb.
Still, to me, one of the most hideous things I was ever privy to seeing was we were playing baseball in grade school. And this guy swung the bat, fucking metal aluminum bat, and freaking let go, and it cracked this guy in the face.
That might have been me. That actually happened to me.
Oh, broke his nose.
Oh,
and the sound that that bat made.
Yikes.
To his nose. That, and when we played baseball here, our annual Fight Network game.
Oh, yeah.
And our pal Corey.
Oh, my God.
Ran into a friggin' light pillar. Oh, yeah. My God. That sound is still in my head. It was
that was awful.
So violent.
That was awful.
I had to go to the hospital. Oh God, baseball is a horrible sport.
Baseball is
I take everything back I said off the top. Watch basketball.
Yeah.
So anyway, we have the Eye of the Tiger match between Kip and BG.
So what were the steps for this one?
This is just a cage match.
Yeah.
Yeah, they really promised a lot in this video that was just going to be a match inside of a cage. They didn't really flex their stipulation muscles in this one. But Kip's entrance video featured him working out and the tiger. It was shots of him in the gym and then a tiger.
Okay.
That was Kip James in 2008, folks. Don West notes about Kip. The size, the strength is legendary as Kip attacks BG at the start. Kip was in control, used a rear chin lock, ran BG into the cage as the crowd booed. He hit a famouser. And West says to just throw in the towel, but BG kicks out of the famouser. And then he jumps off the turnbuckle, misses, and he takes a low blow from BG, who then makes a comeback, hits the shake, rattle, and knee drop for a two count. And then Kip misses BG in the corner, uses a schoolboy, and BG wins at 6:45. And TNA says, we have settled the score. So off of a schoolboy roll-up, this blood feud has been settled between these two.
Mm-hmm.
What a payoff.
Yeah, I mean, I thought a slower, more sluggish match compared to the previous two. But I felt like these two were able to deliver the best that they could at their age. And I actually think Kip looked like in pretty decent shape. But actually, to tell you the truth, I think the two of them probably even looked better, though, in their most recent WWE run than here.
Well, yeah, I mean, Kip was out doing weightlifting competitions, and I mean...
Mm-hmm.
The guy had the fountain of youth. BG offers his hand to help Kip up, and then Kip holds up BG's arm, and then he clotheslines BG. This all happened in about 20 seconds, and Don West went on a roller coaster of emotions from disgust at Kip to forgiveness to back to utter disgust at Kip teasing him with this reunion and stating that he is disgusted at the depths that which Kip has sunk to as Kip does the suck it sign over top BG, which to me, on the level of being disgusted, I mean, clotheslining a guy as opposed to threatening to feed him to a tiger. I mean, Kip was pretty low to begin with. This seemed to be an improvement of sorts that he would only clothesline him after.
Yeah,
trying to right. fake gain his trust.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, the two of them just couldn't believe it. They really couldn't believe it.
Oh, you're kidding me, Mike. Jeremy Borash is with Kurt Angle backstage, who looked like a zombie staring off into outer space and refused to blink. And he talks about beating everyone in the WWE. And then he started watching the competition. And he saw Samoa Joe. And he thought that Joe was an animal, just like him. And said when they fought, Joe took him to the limit. And it took everything he had to beat him. He says it's personal because they're going to find out who is the best. And he must make Joe tap and end his career tonight. He must do this.
I thought a really good promo here from Kurt. And I thought all he did different was just kind of one little thing. And that was he stared off into the distance off camera and cut his promo in a very slow and serious way. And it just made the whole thing seem a bit more intense than usual, like he was possessed.
So at this point, Wei, we've seen a lot of variations of the steel cage format.
Mm-hmm.
What's next? What can we do that's never been done? Up next was the cuffed in the cage match. Cuffed in the cage. Wherein the winner of the match is the one that can successfully remain uncuffed in the cage while his victims are all cuffed to the cage.
Yeah, I must not be a very good viewer of professional wrestling.
Did you skip?
Despite hosting, co-hosting a review show. Because, like, I just sometimes don't pay attention when they announce these rules. Because I'm just like, I just want to see the wrestling. So, like, the match starts and, like, these handcuffs come out. I'm like, oh, okay, it must be somebody's gimmick. Like, you know, maybe like a boss man thing. Somebody, like one of these wrestlers they just have one pair of cuffs. And then everybody starts getting cuffed. I'm like, what's going on? I was completely lost.
So not only did we have this cuff gimmick, we had 11 people inside of this ring for this match. Out first. Oh, this is also a tag team deal. It's all tag teams in this match. We have the team of the Rock and Rave Infection, Lance Hoyt and Jimmy Rave, where Lance asks who wants to get infected tonight. It was supposed to be Kazarian and Eric Young, but Black Rain, no relation to Roman, but we did get a Prince gimmick on this show, and Rellik attacked Eric Young backstage, leaving Kazarian to have to go at it alone. Then we had Black Rain and Rellik, the Motor City Machine Guns, LAX, and then the team of Scott Steiner and Petey Williams.
What do you want me to say to that?
What a lineup, Wei, of teams.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think everybody's pretty solid. Let's see how they do in this match.
So we have 11 with the elimination of Eric Young at the start. Steiner is hitting guys with belly-to-belly suplexes. Steiner has a Feast or Fired briefcase and therefore will get the next TNA title shot at Sacrifice next month. So what happens? They immediately gang up and they all cuff Steiner early on in the match. The guy who will be in a main event next month is the first elimination as he is cuffed to the cage. Eric Young then comes down to the ring, but they won't let him get in the cage, so Eric Young turns around and walks out to the back, leaving Kazarian. Lost in all of this was Alex Shelley, who somehow got cuffed along with Chris Sabin, so the Machine Guns are also eliminated. There was a gringo cutter off the turnbuckle by Homicide to Kazarian off the shoulders of Hernandez. Then Kazarian came back and hit a flux capacitor to Jimmy Rave off the top, and then he goes for one to Hoyt, who blocks it and chokeslams Kazarian from the top turnbuckle, and they cuff Kazarian. LAX gets handcuffed. Then Eric Young returns as his alter ego, Super Eric, which the crowd was chanting for before he came out. He climbs up and hits a high cross off the top of the cage to those in the ring. Rave and Hoyt get cuffed. Then Rellik and Black Rain double team Super Eric. They go to cuff him, but he pulls the old switcheroo, comes out of it, and it's Rellik that has been cuffed, And West says that he has superpowers based off of this trick. And then it's a super Eric Driver to Black Rain, who then cuffs him and wins the match at 10:45. And then he tears the cuffs of Kazarian off and he celebrates with his tag partner. In terms of a match built around a pop at the end for this cult character in Super Eric, very much the Captain New Japan of this point in TNA, the crowd certainly did get into Eric's involvement come the end of it.
Definitely. I thought, you know, the match type is, I was very confused by, and even in execution, I just think it's a really kind of a corny idea that doesn't leave that much, suspense. So I wasn't a fan of it, but I thought the Eric's, Super Eric stuff played out well. The crowd really seemed to like the tease, as obvious as it was.
Lauren was backstage with Samoa Joe's family.
His Ainga.
Yes. Samoa Pete, Samoa Stefan, and Samoa Wayne. And Father Pete states that this is all Joe has ever wanted since he was young, and he will still love his son, whether he wins or loses.
Yeah, the dad struggled a bit off the top, but I thought he got through it fine. I really enjoyed how in this entire pay-per-view, the only backstage segments you got were all leading up to the main event. It wasn't, you know, backstage segments for all these other matches. It was really a show focused only on that one main event.
This was a true main event. It was like the whole show was built around this big match at the end.
It made the main event, by the time it came around, seem like something you had waited all night for, because you were constantly reminded by it, through interviews with the family members, with the managers, with the coaches, and the two guys. So I really like how they handled that.
Up next was a knockouts tag match with Awesome Kong and Raesha Saeed, cheerleader Melissa, taking on Gail Kim and ODB. And ODB chops Kong in the ass at the start. Kim tags in, and she wants Saeed in. And this is her first match, the original Blue Pants, Raesha Saeed. And then she attacks the left arm of Gail Kim. They had a good back and forth. Kim hit a drop kick and a head scissors. Kim was in on the turnbuckle, and Kong runs her into the cage behind the referee's back. And then Kim is seated on the top. Saeed kicks her in the head and into the fence repeatedly. Kim then tags in ODB, and what I wrote down at this point was, after seeing all these gimmick matches like piled onto one another, this was just a straight tag match. And to me, this was like your stomach's a mess and you just want like a ginger ale to soothe it. That's what this match was for me at this point. I enjoyed that there was no stipulations on this. Like right.
You're big on the ginger ale as like a
ginger ale is a great
remedy.
It's a great remedy. That's its purpose in life. Kim climbs the cage and Saeed tries to powerbomb her. Kim holds on, turns into a Hurricane Rana from the top turnbuckle. ODB then ducks. Kong hits Saeed with the spinning back fist, and Kim hits a missile drop kick to Kong, and then ODB with a splash off the top pins Saeed at 8:27. Not the match of the night by any stretch, but I thought this was a fine match.
Yeah, I thought the girls here, led by Gail and Kong, I thought, you know, in general, they were having matches, in particular those two, that were really good. And I thought this match featured some big spots here, some dives off of the top of the cage that rivaled what the men were doing. And I feel like a lot of what's been missing with a lot of the WWE women's matches is that kind of, you know, big risk-taking, big spots within the match that, you know, I thought Gail was able to deliver here. I think seeing Gail Kim work here, I thought she just was so good. And in my opinion, you know, still probably one of the best in North America. Probably not the best, you know, compared to Asuka right now, but I'm sure she's still right up there. Her wrestling is just so smooth and so much more crisp than so many of the other women.
Borash interviews Karen Angle backstage, who has been separated from Kurt for a month, but she is here to support him. He is still the father of her children and is concerned for Kurt if he cannot live up to his own expectations. Then they showed a video for the next match featuring Booker T, who had debuted in TNA November of the prior year, and began a feud with Bobby Roode, who had called him one of the washed-up has-beens from the other side of the tracks. And the angle here, which was a great angle at the time that got over tremendously well, was where Bobby Roode had turned around and accidentally, that being whether it was accidental or not, and punched Sharmell in the face. And this whole video was built around these two, and there was zero mention of Peyton Banks and Sharmell being part of this. It made sense for Sharmell to be included because of the angle, and therefore Peyton Banks, P-A-Y, Peyton Banks. What a gimmick name for Robert Roode. Taking on Booker and Sharmell was our tag match here, and Booker coming out to his knockoff Harlem Heat theme. Very lame.
Well,
can't just give him. I hated these
knockoff themes.
Yes, nothing more second rate than that to me. Everyone knows who it is. Can't give him a new theme. Oh, God, how will they not know it? It's like acknowledging that that was a superior theme music than anything we could come up with.
It really was.
So
this, I think somebody like Booker, though, is so tied
to... This is like a MIDI theme. It sounded so campy.
But somebody like Booker is so tied to his theme, you know? Like, the feel would be off if he didn't have it.
At first.
Yeah.
But it's, you get over it. Give him something new. So, Booker's out. And then Roode blindsides him as they start the match, and Roode's in control. Booker goes for an axe kick, and Roode stops, hits a spine buster, and suddenly we got, like, wrestling holds and an exchange of pin attempts during this blood feud after this man had punched your wife in the face. Just seemed not to really connect with the feud here.
Well, even in a blood feud, you got to rest, right?
Booker does a spin-a-rooney. Misses an axe kick. The bookend gets blocked. And then Booker runs into the cage. Sharmell tags herself in, slaps away at Roode, and then Peyton Banks tags in. Roode is holding her. Sharmell breaks free, and Banks turns her back, not realizing that Sharmell has broken free. And then Banks turns around 180 degrees. Sharmell is long gone from the clutches of Bobby Roode, but this does not stop Banks from still going to slap Sharmell in her pre-existing position, and instead slaps Bobby Roode. And then Sharmell rolls up Banks for the fall at 7:37. I don't know if Sharmell was supposed to stay trapped and was supposed to duck the slap, but this looked awful.
Yeah.
She turned around and Sharmell was not there, and she still slapped Roode.
Mm-hmm.
It looked so goofy. And then Roode and Banks argue about this. Roode berates her and goes to punch her, but then stops and just walks away.
Yeah.
Great match. Lauren interviews Marcus Davis, who is backstage in his kilt on the lockdown couch, and says it was an unbelievable training camp. They were training 2 to 3 times a day. And Joe came out of this a complete fighter and just listed every element of mixed martial arts that he knew. That is what they trained. It's like, yeah, grappling, wrestling, ground and pound, all of it. All of it we did. He's a complete fighter now.
Yeah.
Calisthenics. We did wall walking. Yeah, we did it all.
Yep. Marcus Davis, I thought, was brought in to be a very generic MMA coach. And his interview wasn't as funny as Triggs, but there's nothing wrong with that because this is why Marcus Davis was brought in. He wasn't brought in to be funny or, you know, even have any type of real charisma in a pro wrestling sense. He was here to add some credibility as an MMA coach for Samoa Joe, and I thought he did that.
There was a training video where they show Samoa Joe striking and Marcus Davis compares him to, you know, like shades of Mike Tyson. Yeah. I think Frank Trigg had a better handle on all of this than Marcus Davis. Then we went to the lethal lockdown match. It was Team Cage against Team Tomko. Now, I don't know what this says for my recall, but it took me until the third entrant to realize who was the babyface team in all of this. It turned out Christian Cage was the babyface in all of this, but he made his entrance doing his same usual heel entrance mannerisms. I had no recollection of who was who in this particular time period in TNA. But Team Cage consisted of Christian, Kevin Nash, Sting, Rhino, and Matt Morgan taking on Tomko, AJ Styles, the Dudley Boys, and James Storm. So Cage is out first, then Tomko comes out, but only serves as a distraction for the real entrant, and that is AJ Styles, who appears from behind on the top turnbuckle and hits a phenomenal forearm to the back of Christian's head, and TNA calls it a swerve to start the match.
Mm-hmm. Crowd was really hot for it.
Yeah, they were very hot for
it. I really liked the swerve. I thought it was good.
Tomko's team had won the coin toss, and they have a five-minute period before the additional participants would come in. Styles and Christian, they had a good opening 5 minutes here, ended with a Pele kick. Great crowd heat. Brother Ray was in number three with a Derek Jeter Yankees jersey coming out in Massachusetts, and the crowd just hated him for this. He slammed the cage door onto Christian's head, huge chant of Yankees suck, and this was when Bubba was competing in a t-shirt and black pants. He's a far cry from the Bully Ray look years later.
He's also way fatter at this time.
Yes, this was pre getting into peak physical form.
Yeah.
Rhino was number four and went to gore Bubba, but got stopped by a Styles dropkick. And this crowd was so hot for this tease of a gore. I thought the crowd added a ton to this match. James Storm was number five, coming along with Jacqueline, hit the Eye of Storm to Cage. And then Styles and Cage would fight on top of the cage, and Cage got knocked down to the floor. Kevin Nash was in a lot earlier than I anticipated at number six, caught Styles off the ropes and just snake-eyed him on the top. Cage then climbs back up and does a high cross to Bubba and Storm. Everyone's down. Brother Devon was in seventh. Matt Morgan was in eighth. Genetically jacked and physically stacked, Matt Morgan. Styles blocked a chokeslam from him with a backflip landing on his feet, and the crowd was screaming for every countdown. They were just chanting those numbers at their lungs capacity. Number nine was Tomko, who comes out with a chair, and TNA calls him the swerve artist, and Cage and Tomko are brawling with each other. Devon, did you catch here where he got cut open? Because he was bleeding a ton here from the forehead. Tenth was Sting, who goes after all of the heels with strikes, and this is when the ceiling lowers, the weapons are legal, the old War Games format. Everyone grabs a weapon, they're going at it. Storm climbs onto the roof, Cage follows him up, and they're hitting trash can lid shots to the head of Cage. The fencing on the top of the roof breaks, and then Cage repeatedly hits Storm in the head with a trash can lid. Tomko is using chair shots with Nash easily getting his hands up, and Morgan just eating these chair shots. Sting then applies the Scorpion Deathlock to Tomko, and Styles stops it with a kendo stick. Styles then climbs up to the roof, and we have Cage set up on a table on the roof. Styles then climbs up a ladder on the roof, and Cage climbs up the ladder with Styles, and then Storm tips the ladder over. Both go through the table that is on the roof. Crowd's going nuts for this. The other seven are all laid out on the mat, so they don't even move because they're off camera. And then Storm hits Matt Morgan with a beer bottle, and it ends with Rhino hitting the gore to James Storm and pins him. And this went 26-31.
Mm-hmm.
I thought the match was actually pretty good by Lethal Lockdown standards, and I thought the crowd had a big role in this.
Yeah, I thought the match was pretty good too. But for me, and I'm not really even a fan of War Games matches, because to me, it just feels like nothing matters until, you know,
it's like 18 minutes of just strikes. Yeah. And
but then again, I fully admit that I was only watching the final match, and I wasn't really watching the build up to the match. If I don't know, maybe this feud was like really hot between Team Cage and Team Tomko. Mm. And by the time they touched, maybe the rest of the match was, you know, felt really big too. But to me, just watching it as a match on its own, I found I couldn't really care until, you know, the roof came in. But once it did come in, I thought, the brawl up top was really exciting, you know, to see AJ and Christian fight up there, setting up that ladder on top of that cage, and the tease of Christian throwing AJ off the ladder on top of the cage, I thought was done really well. And, you know,
and they didn't have to go stupid with anything.
They didn't go stupid.
This crowd was on the edge of their seats for the tease of something dangerous. Exactly. That was relatively safe. I mean, there was still some stuff in this match I didn't care for, but...
But when they broke the table up the, at the top, it still looked incredible, but it wasn't stupidly dangerous.
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of Lethal Lockdown matches. I wasn't a giant fan of the War Games matches, but I thought this was one of the better ones. With everyone involved, they minimized the risk, and this crowd was great. They were really into this a lot. Then we got a video for the main event, and we go back to the announcement of Angle joining TNA, the infamous headbutt on Impact, then their matches at Genesis 06, Turning Point, Final Resolution, and then Hard Justice from the prior year. And then we got predictions from Christian, Frank Trigg, Jim Cornette, Kevin Nash, Mike Carlson from Real Fighter Magazine, talking about how the fans want name versus name fights. And this was just a few weeks before the Oscar De La Hoya... No, sorry, this was a year after. Sorry, that was May of 07 with De La Hoya and Mayweather. So Mike Carlson telling us what the people want. And Joe says, every time it's just you and I, you've lost. Which didn't seem to make much sense, given that Joe had lost three of their four matches.
Maybe he means if there's interference.
Well, Genesis, there was really no interference. Anyway, Wow, it was just a line. Karen Angle is showing ringside. And then Frank Trigg joins Mike Tenay and Don West for commentary. They go over the keys to victory. And Mike Tenay labels Angle's focus unmatched and is happy when that Kurt was happy, rather, that Karen wanted to separate. Because now he can train and focus full time. So it's been a positive that his marriage has been falling apart. Joe walks backstage and then we go into a video preview for him. There is a fire dance entrance with his family. And then we see Angle walking backstage into a video for him. And they say in the video, he has been champion for almost 1 year, which he had won the title in October. It was now April. So it would be exactly half of that. Angle and Joe for the TNA title. Marcus Davis is there. He will present the title to the winner. Kurt Angle representing Hayabusa. So he probably got more sponsorship dollars here than some UFC fighters on the bottom tier of the Reebok deal. And barefoot as well for this.
Yeah, he was in full MMA gear. Arms, whatever, wrapped. And actually, he didn't have the gloves. That's what he didn't have.
No, this was bare knuckle.
Yeah.
But before the match can begin, he has security remove Karen from ringside. And Karen is pissed. Mm-hmm. She will not forget this.
Karen's actually a really great performer, too. And, you know, who would have really thought? But she was... What was their storyline here? They had legit separated at this point, right?
I don't think they had actually broken up at this point. I think this was still just storyline. And then it was... To me, I think it was... I don't know the exact time frame. But probably, you know, they...
Okay.
Because the Jarrett stuff came out. Oh, I'm trying to remember the exact.
Okay. Well,
probably a year or so after this.
Yeah. My favorite part about this, though, as Karen was being escorted out, was that he was being escorted out by Atlas Security.
Yes.
So we had the ECW Don West looking security guy here as Don West is calling this.
Oh, wow. Yes.
So how? Very meta. Imagine that photo backstage between the two of them.
There were leg kicks by Kurt to start the match, brief clinch, then Joe is hitting leg kicks, and Frank Trigg explains how it will be easier for Kurt Angle to escape any leg or heel hooks without having his shoes on as the reasoning for this, which is great. And yeah. Because
I buy it.
If you remember back to the Kurt Angle Eddie Guerrero feud when they took the boot off of Eddie and the announcers would explain, oh, it's going to be so much harder now without the boot, it actually would make it easier to escape. So this was a more psychologically sound thinking here for Lockdown.
But at the same time, the boot protects your ankle.
Does, but it also gives you less resistance.
Yeah, but it's, you know, I think it's one of those, it works both ways types of things.
Well, why don't you put a boot on and then we'll test this out.
Okay.
To see how much
I don't have any
wiggle boots. Room you get. Joe kicks him in the face and then hip tosses Angle, and Trigg acknowledges some of the fat that Joe has as being deceptive, and Mike Tenay is quick to jump in and say not to judge a book by its cover in regards to Samoa Joe. Mm-hmm. And Angle hits a throw and then into an arm triangle with Joe getting a rope break. Huge chance for both from the crowd. There's a belly to belly delivered to Joe. Uppercut. Kurt goes to mount him with strikes, and then Joe blocks an armbar, and Angle clips the knee of Joe, applies a figure four, and keeps it applied for a long time. Joe eventually turns it over, and it gets broken with the rope break. Angle then attacks the left knee further. Joe hit a huge lariat. Both are down. Joe starts making a comeback and hits a running knee into the corner, uses the right knee and not the damaged left knee. Angle then counters a muscle buster into an ankle lock onto the bad leg. Joe is able to get out. Joe stacks him with a power bomb. He kicks out, and Joe applies a lion tamer, putting his knee to the spine of Angle, and then transitions to an STF, traps the arm, applying a crossface, and from that submission, Angle grabs the ankle, turning it into an ankle lock, and Joe breaks free. Joe goes back to the crossface again, gets released, and then Angle runs at Joe into another crossface. He gets up to his feet, and Angle slams his way out, applies the ankle lock again. Joe cannot break free. He turns Angle around and applies the coquina clutch, but Angle fights to the rope, and he uses the referee's shirt in order to get to the rope, and Trigg thinks this is brilliant. Mike Tenay is disgusted at these tactics by Kurt Angle to get the rope break. Angle slam is blocked. Angle then runs into the cage, gets hit with a super kick, and Joe places him on the top turnbuckle for the muscle buster and wins this match clean, 17 minutes and 35 seconds. And Marcus Davis hands the title to the complete fighter, Samoa Joe, and celebrates in the ring with him.
I thought a really great match. I thought it was full of intensity, full of realism, and I thought they used the MMA influence well while still keeping it a professional wrestling match. Compared to the Angle Benoit match from Backlash 2001, I thought this was a more modern post-UFC boom version of a
similar, I like this one better.
Similar type of match. I thought this match featured a lot more striking, a lot more takedowns, and less emphasis on the grappling exchanges, but it's very interesting to compare the two. I thought TNA did a great job in building the anticipation for this match leading up to the main event. With all the backstage segments.
This was probably the best promoted main event in TNA history. I think that's pretty, with maybe the exception of the first Angle Joe match.
Sure. And I thought Trigg was great in the role. I thought he, you know, he wasn't really full on heel or anything here. He was just kind of more so your MMA commentator. And I thought he sounded like a really good fit actually for this type of match. And, to me, this was like the peak of Joe's run in TNA. Was his championship win here. This was before the kidnapping, before the face tattoo, Okado, you know. And this was when, to me, Joe was like main eventer and serious main eventer and champion in TNA.
So this show with a much different build, the neighborhood of buys they did was about 55,000, which was up considerably to what a TNA pay-per-view did at the time, which was usually around, you know, your 30,000, give or take. Very successful. And then, you know, coming out of this, I mean, when would you go back to this match? How much time would you let lapse before you go back to a match like this?
I mean, this was already five matches. To me, watching this, it seemed like the culmination and the end of the feud was Joe winning the belt, right? So I would maybe wait, I don't know, at least 6 months, maybe a year.
And do it on pay-per-view?
Sure.
Well, the following Impact, that Thursday, they announced that next week on free television is the rematch. On that very Impact, coming out of lockdown, we did a segment where, because he had lost the title, Kurt Angle no longer got his locker room, and he was reduced to tears, crying.
Mm-hmm.
And then we got the rematch on Impact.
Yeah.
And then, after that, they announced it would be Joe, Angle, and Scott Steiner in a three-way at Sacrifice, which did not happen because Angle actually got hurt, and then Kazarian got put into his place to headline Sacrifice. And they never did another match like this, built not even so much the execution of the match, because I think that's what a lot of people just hung their hat on, that, oh, you can't do this kind of match with everyone on the roster. But the build-up, you could.
Yeah.
This was no bullshit. This was no stupid overthinking, overbooking of a main event. It was two guys finding out who's the best.
Yeah.
with training videos and the, this was, if this had flopped, it would be one thing, but it was a noticeable difference in pay-per-view business.
Mm-hmm.
And they never went back to this. And yeah, it was one of those great mysteries of this worked. What would happen if you were to keep your, if you have such a need for certain comedic stuff, can leave that on your undercard, but your main event should be special.
Yeah, sure. And I wouldn't want every match to be like this. I thought there were times where they were a little too obvious with the MMA stuff. I mean, I think it worked for this because this was like, you know, kind of their first time doing it. But I wouldn't want every single match to be like this. But there's certainly there are elements of the promotion that I think could have transferred to any pro wrestling match, like focusing on your main event with every single backstage segment, or at least the majority of them. You know, some of the vignettes, some of the training was good. And in the end, it was just, it seemed like a traditional way to build a pro wrestling match is what it was.
Did you have any conclusions? I mean, watching this show and you look at where TNA is today, what they had at their disposal in 2008. I mean, this was certainly, this lockdown event is not a great snapshot of TNA. It was a great night for them, which featured a great build up to a pay-per-view. But to me, it was, you also saw a lot of the issues here. I mean, for all the talk of getting different characters here on this show, they really had an issue with making stars and getting people to buy their shows. And that was a big struggling point. But TNA in 2008, though, I mean, you look at them, they were said to be profitable in 2008. So
yeah,
given the Spike TV deal and given a lot of their international deals at the time, money they were making at live events, I mean, it was night and day from where things are today.
Sure. Right. I feel like they had a really strong, main event program in these two headlining. I think the mid card, you know, was okay at the time, but I would have liked to have seen guys like an AJ or like some of your X Division members kind of getting more of that push towards the main event, rather than kind of being kept on sort of the bottom side of the card at this time. I thought there was still a lot of maybe too much reliance on some of the older guys for their star power, like a Kip James or BG James, that I didn't necessarily feel.
Even Kevin Nash. I think TNA really got drunk off that idea of we need a show that has all these recognizable names.
But remember, I mean, this was even before the Hogan stuff. And
yeah,
that problem
would get way worse.
So,
and they didn't bring the added viewers that they were designed to have.
Mm-hmm.
I think you could have taken, at this period of time, Nash disappears. I mean, Scott Steiner was a fun character to have on there, but he was not a necessity. I think the one thing we have learned with TNA, it's that when they were on Spike, I think you were guaranteed your same audience pretty much every week, give or take a few thousand. They did their million plus viewers every single weekend, sometimes well above a million viewers.
Yeah. I think there's definitely a role even for guys like a Sting,
sure,
on the card, but I would much prefer them use Sting in a way that would also,
he's special as that guy.
Special as that guy, and also in a way to promote him against, some of your up and coming talent, in a way to, like what they did with Sting and Seth Rollins. I thought it was a perfect use of Sting. Unfortunately, TNA didn't necessarily do it the same way when Sting was more physically capable to do something like, a program like that. But I certainly think that there's a room for veterans, but I'd rather see veterans against new guys versus veterans.
Yeah. And that,
versus,
I think
versus.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Yeah.
And I think that was one thing you look at this time. It's easy to look back in hindsight, but I think also, mm-hmm, even in 2008, they did have an ability in 2005 when their pay-per-views were on fire every month. I mean, they were doing decent pay-per-view business by their standards at that point.
Mm-hmm.
And then it dropped as they brought in a lot of these stars in 06, in 07, at a time when they had a lot more visibility. And at this time, an AJ Styles, a Samoa Joe, all those kinds of performers, WWE wasn't taking a look at any of these guys. It was very much they were closed to those people. So you had a market of talent all to yourself in essence, because TNA could have brought in a lot of these other guys and kept them long term and built things around them. And I think that there was always, it was just trying to appeal to so many different people, and let's bring back the WCW audience and let's have familiar names because we don't believe that a promotion built around these performers is enough. And I think if you had had the faith in it that you did display in 2005, who knows where they would have been if you had concentrated on that with solid creative and logical characters, storylines like you got in the main event to just build up things in a way. If you did that month after month, would you have been able to build a solid foundation and been a much more successful promotion over the next 8 years?
Maybe, maybe not.
Well,
we don't know.
Our feedback here, we only have one here from Christian, who I guess there wasn't as much of a demand to go pay a dollar here for Lockdown. But Christian,
well, you can see the main event for free on TNA's own YouTube channel.
Oh, well, there you go. Well, then why do they charge for the event? They should just put the whole
Well, if you want to see the Lethal Lockdown or the Escape the Cage.
Yeah, or a live or Tiger.
Cuff the Cage match.
All right, Christian says, this show really highlights the two sides of TNA. On one hand, you have their biggest match ever in Joe and Angle, which got them the most pay-per-view buys ever. Is one of the best matches in TNA history and was built as such a huge deal from the very beginning of this show. You had TNA intro the show in an empty arena about it, West and Borash in the crowd asking the fans about it, and every backstage segment being about the main event, making this match seem like the biggest in their history. It's such a shame that they couldn't carry this into Joe's title reign. He's probably one of the worst booked champions they had, and that's the biggest shame coming out of this show. The other side of this is the rest of the card. Just too many gimmicks in terms of matches and wrestlers. I think this was when Russo was way too into the characters for every wrestler, and we ended up with the garbage like Stone Cold Shark Boy, Curry Man returning, Black Rain, Super Eric, and Little Petey Pump. There was also way too many gimmicks added to the cage, and with too many wrestlers involved, I mean, there were only two singles matches and four matches with six or more people involved. I paid £1 to watch this show, and happily, the main event is worth that for sure. Otherwise, I would have been really annoyed at myself for paying for this show.
See, I really like Stone Cold Shark Boy and Curry Man, and, you know,
there's nothing wrong with comedy characters, but I just thought they were so overrun with them, right, in particular in the X Division, that it just became such a go-to that every person had to have something yeah. like this. You don't need a promotion where you have Super Eric and you have Shark Boy and you have Black Machismo.
Mm-hmm.
And that was just, and Curry Man. Like, there was a pattern here, and those are great one-off characters to have.
They were,
but those are not people you build anything around.
It was essentially your, what do they call them? Your, what do you call it? The minis. It's like the minis division. They're small, light guys, and they're kind of there for comedy and, you know, fast wrestling.
And yeah, I just think, and I just felt it was a lot too when you would present them. They're just there for comedy, but then they have to go out and have these great matches. And at some point, there is a disconnect there.
It makes it a lot tougher for those guys to transition to the main event scene.
Like if Kurt and Samoa Joe, this is an extreme example. If they were just doing all comedy and then had to do a match like this.
Mm-hmm.
It wouldn't have been as received as such because these are not serious characters to us. They're goofy characters, and now you're telling me to take them serious. That was what the X Division was. When the match began, the characters had to take a back seat to the performers.
Mm-hmm.
And it just resulted in, I just think, nothing sustainable for these characters long term. All right, so that ends our look at Lockdown 2008, an interesting show to look back to in hindsight from April of 2008. Next week on this show, Way, we are going to review the recently released documentary on the Dudley Boys that has gotten a lot of praise of late, which the WWE has just put out, Straight Out of Dudleyville.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to go straight in there and review this documentary.
Yeah, straight into Dudleyville.
We're going to go straight into Dudleyville.
Yep.
Population unknown. So that is coming up next week on the show. You can always leave your feedback at lawradio.proboards.com. Thursday on the site, we will have the results of the lip sync contest. So if you submitted or just want to watch, that will be up Thursday at youtube.com/liveaudiowrestling. You can also download the Law from this past Sunday night running through Payback. We've got an interview with Kevin Kelly up on the site, chatting Global Wars this Sunday, and of course, review a Raw from Monday night's show. So that is it, Way. You have a great 24 hours. Until we meet again to watch some music videos.
Yeah.
And we'll see if comedy can draw on our YouTube channel.
Oh.
For free.
Yeah.
That's the goal.
Mm-hmm.
All right. And we're going to end things off with a special treat. It's an Easter egg, folks. We're going to go back to the Law from the night of Lockdown 2008. Here is Dan the Mouth Lovranski chatting with Dave Meltzer just about an hour after Lockdown wrapped up that night in April of 2008.
Let's start, of course, talking a little bit about tonight's TNA Lockdown pay-per-view. I really enjoyed the main event, but I felt the undercard was filled with too many matches, with too many people, with too much plunder.
I thought going in, the thing was is that the whole card was really built around two matches, and it was, and the people who came for those two. So it was one of those cards where either the two matches delivered or they didn't, and I thought they did. But I knew going in that the undercard was overbooked with needless matches that wasted time, that accomplished nothing, and that some of them weren't good, some of them were good, but ultimately just too many multiple-man matches.
Yeah, if you look at the card, Dave, there was only two one-on-one matches the entire pay-per-view.
Yeah, and one of them was terrible.
Exactly. Well, Kip and BG, we expected it. But, I mean, that handcuff silliness, that women's reverse cage match.
Well, I mean, at least the women's reverse cage match was quick and painless. I mean, but it was a dumb idea.
Exactly.
Yeah, the X Division thing, I thought the finish was kind of clever, but again, it was a dumb idea.
Yeah.
The handcuff thing was just dumb, but I thought that what they did as far as, like, you know, with Eric Young and everything, I thought that that was kind of a cute thing that worked, you know, for an undercard comedy match. It's just that, you know, all that handcuff stuff was just stupid.
Yeah, I just found it to be too much, and even the 10-man with the two teams, it was just too much for me. I find those matches very tiring, especially after you've watched an entire undercard of matches like that. It's a bit much.
Yeah, well, one of the real big problems is that they feel this need, and thank God WWE doesn't feel this need, that everyone on the roster has to be on the pay-per-view.
Yeah.
And, I mean, someone told me that there were 48 workers on this show. And
wow.
To me, it's like, you know, you can do a great show with 16 workers.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
And they would have done a better show. They would have done a better show eliminating a couple of those matches. You know, obviously the women's match was needless. And the handcuff match, they could have just had one good tag match with, like, LAX against one of those other teams and just had a nice tag match.
Yep.
It would have been a lot better. And the X Division match, Jay Lethal could have defended against
one
or two
person
of those guys.
Exactly.
And it would have been, although I thought that was a good match, yeah. But I mean, the point is that it's still, you could have done the same thing.
Yeah.
You know, without it. And also, the other thing is that one of the things with those multiple matches that was just a killer is that everyone got their individual ring entrance.
Yep.
It's like, you don't need 48 ring, I know it wasn't that many, but you don't need that many ring entrances in one night.
Yeah, no, I think a little too overbooked and overambitious on the bottom. However, the main event, I thought, again, with the way they've booked it over the past 3 weeks with the MMA angle and the fact that Joe and Angle really did a MMA match basically for most of it, I thought it came off quite well, and I really enjoyed it as a match.
I liked the main event a lot. The one thing that I liked about the show a lot is that while watching the show, you knew what the main event was, and it was really the only match that mattered. And I thought that the build-up during the show with all of the different interviews, whether it was
right.
Kurt or Karen Angle or Marcus Davis or Frank Trigg or, you know, the montage with all those guys, which had already been on television, they opened the show going to the fans in the stands. They made it like this was the biggest match in TNA history.
Mm-hmm.
So when Joe and Angle, and when they showed the backstage of them coming out
yeah.
in a different way, And Kurt's out there in, you know, MMA gear as opposed to pro wrestling gear. When they came out and squared off in a non-pro wrestling thing, that crowd was so buzzing.
Yeah, yep.
And there was a lot of lessons to be learned. And, I mean, it felt like it felt like a world title match from the 70s. I mean,
right.
Obviously the moves were 2008 moves because they were MMA moves. But the psychology and realism was that 70s
yep.
world title thing. And I thought, in that sense, I liked the match. I thought it was an epic match. But the other thing was I congratulate those two guys because, you know, Kurt Angle and Joe could go out there and do the same pro wrestling match that they've done on all those pay-per-views.
Yeah.
And it's a great match, and it's easy. And, I mean, that was a gutsy move because UWF style or UFC style or however you want to say what they were kind of attempting to do, that's something that could have flopped.
Right.
And there are people who thought it did, but obviously the live crowd loved it.
Yep.
And so to me, it's like the people who thought it flopped, you don't know what pro wrestling is because pro wrestling is not, you cannot, you know, one of the things about pro wrestling is that you cannot be narrow-minded. Sometimes, if you had asked me if they had done this match, ahead of time and stay, and someone would have told me, Kurt is going to do this. This is the match Kurt's going to do. I'm going to go, Kurt has lost his mind. It's not going to work. But it did, but it worked.
Yeah,
and I give him all the credit in the world for having the guts to do it. And you know, even if it didn't work, I give him credit for the guts, but I give him real credit for pulling it off because that was, it was, you know, for all the reasons we know UFC is real, so you can't copy UFC in a pro wrestling match, and UWF stuff has never even been exposed in the United States, blah, blah, blah. It can't work, it can't work. The crowd went wild.
They did.
And the other thing that was so good about it is that they made every single move in that match from start to finish meant something.
Right.
Except for one spot where they were in the figure four too long, which I thought was but that's like minor. But when they got to the ropes, I mean, those people were so into those rope breaks. And they were so into those submissions, and they were so into that match, and, you know, it was an atmosphere that TNA has never created in a main event in its history. I'm not saying it's the best match in TNA history, because it wasn't, but they created a... TNA's big problem to me has always been that everyone is booked like a mid-card comedy act.
Right.
From start to finish. And this time, the card was booked like a mid-card comedy act.
It was, except for the main event.
Except the main event was a real main event.
That's right.
And it was, you had no doubt what it was going in, and when the show was over, you were thinking, that was a great main event, and all that other stuff may not have been good, but we saw a great main event.
Yeah, absolutely.